Hello and a very warm welcome, viewers. You're watching the brand new edition of To The Point with your host, Kriti Mishra. The Ministry of Home Affairs discharges multifarious responsibilities, the important among them being internal security, border management, center-state relations, administration of UTs, management of Central Armed Police Forces, and of course, disaster management. But the outbreak of COVID-19 pandemic and concerns over its rapid spread to Indian shores dominated the activities of the Union Ministry of Home Affairs since early last year. The coordinated efforts of the center, the states, and the UTs has resulted in decline in the number of active cases. Government of India has constituted empowered groups to look into the various aspects of the management of the COVID-19 pandemic. And joining us on the show today is the Union Home Secretary and convener of the Empowered Group for Pandemic Response and Coordination, Mr. Ajay Bhalla. Sir, welcome to Sansad TV and thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Sir, first and foremost, global actors are pushed deeper into uncharted territory because of the pandemic. It has disrupted economies worldwide. How has been the experience of handling and coordinating since last year, sir?
Yes, you rightly started that it's an uncharted territory. It was for all of us. When it started initially from Wuhan, we started with regulating the arrivals at airports and gradually curtailing flights. And then when we realized it's like a pandemic, then Epidemics Act was invoked by various states. But more and more we learned about it by end week of March last year. We realized that we need to do something across the country. And then Ministry of Home Affairs stepped in and the National Disaster Management Authority, Chairman, Prime Minister, took a review and decided that we need to bring uniformity across the country in the measures which we undertake. And that's where we started with the national lockdown. With restrictions, actually, I would say we brought in restrictions across the country on movement of people and on gathering of people, and basically allowed essential services to be operated initially. And then gradually over a period of time, when more we realized about the gained knowledge about the pandemic and parallelly created infrastructure for handling it, we started unlocking also. So the empowered group under me at that stage was mainly to deal with the unlocking of the lockdown phases. And gradually, after interacting with various stakeholders, we evolved a process of what services can be opened, which places we can now open gradually and see what is the reaction. And at some stages, train movement was started and then industry was opened. And gradually, we reached a stage in September where many activities were opened up and all. So that was a learning for all of us. And during this period, we could create infrastructure for not only a medical side, but all other things also, which was required as part of this thing, like hospital beds, PPE kits, masks, ventilators, RT-PCR testing kits and RT-PCR testing laboratories. We started with one in February of last year. And then now with many thousands we have got all across the country, our capacities have gone up. And of course, at some stage, movement of oxygen also, which of course, the last year, the demand was little less compared to what we have faced this year. So this is how we started and we also learned along with the process and were able to control the pandemic largely across the country and cases came down. I mean, there were different peaks here and there in different cities, but finally it was under control by end January.
Absolutely, sir. And we are keeping our fingers crossed for it. But, sir, in a fresh order, you have said strict implementation of containment and other measures has led to declining trend in the number of new and active cases across states and the UTs. Sir, what is your current assessment, given the fact that many states are partially easing the localized lockdowns?
See, this time, if you have seen, there was no national level lockdown as the disease was appearing at a different pace in different states or different cities, I would say. And accordingly, the regulation of activities should have been done. Putting across the nation lockdown perhaps was not warranted this time because in many states, there was no cases actually, especially Northeast and all. When the Northern India started, the Northeast was totally free. Odisha side, Bihar side, there was hardly any cases. So a national level lockdown consciously was avoided, so that commercial activities, economic activities are not affected. And by the time the phase, this phase started, we realized that a lot of requirement of oxygen and all is there. And oxygen doesn't come just easily. It has to be ferried from different places.
Yes.
And there are various related industries of pharma and other this thing, which as a lockdown would have got disrupted. So this time it was the local level restrictions imposed under our guidelines that we kept on saying that you manage the micro containment zones in a manner that you are able to control the disease wherever it is there. So many states did that, and luckily they have been able to bring it down. But as I said, this time it was more phased. Now it has gone towards South India, and the cases now in Odisha and Bengal are increasing in the Northeast.
Yes.
But as you are the national level, cases largely have come down. It is now below 1.5 lakhs per day. We can still see large number of cases in Tamil Nadu, among the southern states. Kerala is the number two. But looking at some cases, Odisha and West Bengal also are showing rising trends, and then northeastern states. But northern India, western India definitely has declined. And almost, we can say the situation is very well under control. And in those places also, situation, if you look at the state level, things are coming down. But some districts, some city may still be showing different results, and some cases are still going up.
Sir, as you mentioned that there are concerns about southern India and northeastern India, particularly about, sir, northeast, because there are constraints of geography, there are constraints of terrain. How are we ramping up the infrastructure there?
See, at this phase, we see the requirement of oxygen was more besides the medicines and all. So already for northeast, we have learning experience from northern India, western India. We have already mobilized oxygen cylinders, oxygen concentrators, and whatever else is required. Now we have sufficient ISO tankers to carry oxygen. We have been carrying oxygen on 20-ton containers, on trains. So that all those things we have tied up as far as Eastern India and Northeastern India is concerned. And of course, the requirement is not as big as it would have, was in Northern and Western India. But still, from eastern part of the country, where mostly the steel makers are there and where liquid medical oxygen is available, we can easily carry it. We have planned that. We are definitely monitoring it very, very closely. And within the northeast, especially in the hilly states, it's difficult to carry the 20-ton containers and all. So largely, it is carried by cylinders. So sufficient cylinders and refilling capacities have been created there to ensure that sufficient oxygen, in case it is needed, would be available.
All right, sir, this reminds me that Ministry of Home Affairs invoked Disaster Management Act 2005 and ordered free interstate movement of oxygen carrying vehicles. Now, most of these plants, as you said, were located in the east, leading to long transportation hauls and a turnaround time of at least 6 to 7 days for each tanker. How was it working on the logistics part of it?
See, we faced the difficulty for about a week, especially the crisis. If there is oxygen generation capacities in northern India also. We have it in Haryana and Rajasthan and Gujarat, Maharashtra. Initially, when the panics came in, there was reaction that no, our oxygen should not be taken out. That's why we invoked Disaster Management Act to ensure that oxygen supplies should be as per the direction of the central government. Nobody should stop movement of tankers of oxygen. They should be treated, given a status of an ambulance. The green corridor should be created for fast movement. And as the requirement was going up, additional capacities were being created in the steel plants as in the refineries to whatever extent it was possible. So I would definitely like to compliment the industry that they supported our efforts very well and diverted most of the oxygen to this purpose. And we also, with efforts of Air Force and Navy, could bring in a lot of containers from abroad and use them for carrying oxygen. But creating this whole logistics chain took us about 5 to 7 days. So for 5-7 days, we faced some shortage in some places. But that also, with the local generation in northern India and western India, we were able to stabilize the situation. And now, we are very confident that any requirement of oxygen, whatever we produce as liquid capacity, we can carry it throughout the country easily. We have sufficient capacities created.
We understand that law and order is the state subject, but checking, black marketing and hoarding, that must have been the biggest challenge.
See, that was a local level problem, that monitoring systems in the hospitals needed to be created. Delhi immediately fell in line, and we created a portal for them where which could monitor the each hospital every day. Just for example, I mean, one hospital for the normal surgeries used to have the capacity, which is once filled up, used to last for 6 to 7 days, because that kind of oxygen requirement was not there. In COVID time, the same capacity was getting exhausted in 6 to 8 hours. So naturally, it needed to be filled up more than 2 times in a day. So that kind of logistics infrastructure was not there. And refillers capacities also were not to that extent available. But very quickly, we could mobilize some of the idle capacities lying in Rishikesh and some of the government PSUs. Those were revived overnight, and the refilling of cylinders started from there and used to be ferried here. DRDO did a lot of good job in refilling cylinders in Rishikesh and bringing them here on regular basis. So that helped us. But yes, in some small place or here and there, there would be a panic. People would go and buy cylinders at higher price, for which, at least in Delhi police took some action, arrested some people for this purpose, and ensured that such things are not rampant. 2 days, yes, it happened.
Yes, sir. Must have been difficult controlling it. But sir, since last year to this point, there wasn't even 1 second or one moment where we felt crunch or shortage of essential supplies. How did you ensure seamless movement of goods so that supply chain disruptions were completely avoided, as we saw?
See, initially, right in the beginning, we set up a control room in the Ministry of Home Affairs for this purpose only. And it used to monitor all across the country that what exactly is happening as far as movement is concerned. Initially, March last year, our focus was on medicines first, then ports and manufacturing areas where the essential commodities are being manufactured. And then movement was our next point that we used to monitor, and we used to be in touch with the states. Wherever we used to hear in some places, police has stopped movement of trucks, cargo and all, which is part of the supply chain for many essential things. So we used to intervene and have it resolved. So that control room with additional lines, additional manpower worked very well and enabled us to monitor all across the country a movement of essential goods. So that we could monitor with railways jointly, joint efforts were there with the railways also. So throughout that period when the lockdown was in full this thing, we ensured that there's movement. Now, my empowered group monitors the logistics also in the reconstituted form. So we keep a watch at the ports, airports, and on the movement. And generally, there is no complaint now of any shortage or any restrictions by any state as far as essential goods or cargo is concerned. And we have been able to ensure that sufficient production of essential commodities is there. FCI has done the record procurement in both her Rabi and Kharif season. So that itself shows the system didn't get affected by lockdown's initiation.
Absolutely, sir. But how is it coordinating with the states 24/7? So there's a desk that coordinates with them. How is it that constantly that monitoring or coordination activity goes on?
Initially, in Home Ministry, what we did, a joint secretary and senior level officers were earmarked for each state. We used to call them as area officers. They used to coordinate with all the states, because in those days there were different issues of migrant labor, food related camps, services to these people, movement of trains for migrant labor and all. So each senior officer used to be in touch with the states. Definitely at higher levels also we used to coordinate regularly. At the cabinet secretary level, there were regular meetings with the chief secretaries and all. So we kept a watch and ensured one thing that those days was necessary was these guidelines are understood by people who implemented it at the lowest level. At the senior most level, things are understood. It is sent, people read it, media also publishes it. But at the lowest level, at the road where a policeman is actually implementing it, the guidelines needed to be understood by each and everyone. There was dynamic changes in the guidelines over a period of time. So people at times were used to still look at the older guidelines and implement it that way. So there were difficulties. But then, I mean, with our continuous monitoring and being in touch with the states, we could manage it very well. I must thank all the chief secretaries who cooperated very well. at any hour in the night or day, we could talk to them. They were willing to resolve the problem, especially at times of movement of migrant labor. There were some issues which we all of us together could resolve.
Mr. Bhalla, you recently chaired a high-level meeting to review the management of the COVID-19 pandemic across all UTs. How are the UTs faring in this fight?
UTs are, again, I mean, some of them have very remote areas and infrastructure is very poor. So we used to regularly monitor them as their territories administered by central government directly. So, I mean, I would say that UTs did quite well. And if I look at the data in today's date, UTs have done much better now compared to the national average as far as COVID or vaccination or handling is concerned. Today, I would only say that we are looking at Puducherry, where cases are active cases are more than 10,000, and J&K, of course, being a larger UT. Otherwise, all UTs have less than 2,000 cases, and per day cases are less than 200 in most of the UTs. So it's quite well, and some of the UTs did very well in vaccination drive also, especially Dadra Nagar Haveli has done 100% on healthcare workers and all. And frontline workers also 96%, which is quite good. So, I mean, I feel happy that UTs have relatively done very well.
All right, sir, let's shift focus to vaccination now. As we know that Government of India has launched the world's largest vaccination drive against this pandemic. What is your assessment of the current situation and as far as the vaccine availability is concerned?
See, we must look at it from mid-January onwards or last year with when Prime Minister started reviewing the manufacture of vaccine and how it's going to work out. It's an, as I said, it's a new territory, new area of a pandemic, a virus which was unknown. Still, we must compliment the scientific community for doing research and finding out genomes and then coming out with domestic production of vaccines and learning a lot of things about it. And we started way back in mid-January with the healthcare workers. I must say that it was a very well-thought plan of vaccinating. Ours is a very large country. So we must have a very well-thought system. And let's accept it that overnight capacities can't be added in these things. After it's a question of life and death. Suddenly, as a hit and trial, you can't go and say, use this or use that. We realized this in the recent times when there was excess problems in the hospitals.
Yes.
Overnight beds capacity, we increased, but it was up to 3 lakh cases per day. But if the cases have gone beyond 4 lakhs, naturally there had to be stress on the system. So similarly, vaccines plan started very well. It is actually today, I would say we have delivered 22 crore vaccines till yesterday. I mean, it's been already given to people. And many are in stock, many are in pipeline. It always takes time to ramp up the capacities. Let's see, I mean, as of now, there are only 2 manufacturers and they have been ramping up their capacity, which will show results in the month of June now, definitely. And from July onwards, definitely there'll be sufficient vaccine. So it has been announced by the head of NAGVAC and all the national expert group, the national task force, that this is how the plan would be. This is how we are going to go about it. So we perhaps need to have a little more patience on this front. And the whole country can't be vaccinated in 1 month. So let's be patient with it. And because from mid-January, when it started with health workers, then frontline workers, then 60 years and above, then 45 years and above, it was, I mean, no, there was no issue ever. Suddenly, the pressure came that younger population should also be vaccinated. So, I mean, had it been a month later, perhaps we would have done very well. But in the month of May, there was no extra production. Now, there definitely in June, we have extra production. Things will ease out very nicely. By July, you would see there's no problem.
But, sir, then there are concerns of the third wave. If at all, we have to brave third wave, how prepared are we? Because we don't know how the virus is going to behave.
That is true. But the second wave also, as I said, didn't happen in one go. It happened in different places at different times. So we need to keep a watch that how the third wave, if there is any. Because if you keep a watch and there's a COVID-appropriate behavior is enforced, we should be able to handle it. I mean, perhaps we have to get used to no large social gatherings and other things. Suddenly in January, February, we felt things are quite okay. So one can open up, it's well understood socially. But now one has to be careful, and we should not create this thing. See, when phase one, because of lockdown, less movement, the spread was not that much. Phase two suddenly happened because there was total thing got opened up and people were moving across full country and abroad also. Now we need to be careful. So focus again has to be on the, we need to keep a watch in each district, I would say, instead of the state. See, each state behaved differently in phase two, but now we need to go to the lowest level at district level and see that if there is anything, any instance where cases are going up, and we need to check it right there. If you can check it at that level, perhaps it won't spread like a third. I mean, such peaks may keep on coming at smaller levels in smaller geographies, but those can easily be handled. So we need to be more alert. And Health Ministry is already working on advising the states in that direction. At the national level, this empowered groups also, Dr. Paul's group is there. They keep on looking at as experts and say that we need to keep a watch now at a much lower level also, not only city, but at the rural area level also, we need to keep a watch. So if we are able to do that, it won't be a difficult wave to handle.
Absolutely, sir. It is incumbent upon all of us to follow the COVID appropriate behavior. But sir, before we sign off, lastly, we just battled Taute then Yas. What is the status of preparedness for dealing with natural disasters that may arise during the Southwest Monsoon 2021? And also the fact that we are already reeling under the pandemic.
Yeah, I mean, Southwest Monsoon is generally at times where some floods and some cyclones appear during or after the monsoon. So we are, we have a well laid down drill as a ministry which deals with disaster management. This year also, I have held a meeting with all the relief commissioners. Yes. We have reviewed their preparedness, and it's again a continuous process. The control room system for disaster also gets activated very regularly, and it keeps a watch on the states. IMD has become very accurate in giving predictions to us, and we have created a system of communicating it to the states well in time. In case of cyclones, we generally evacuate people well in time, basically fishermen and all. During monsoon, we keep a watch on the rivers, their catchment areas and all, and make predictions of quantum of water coming and all. So generally in low-lying areas, people are evacuated before this thing. The NDRF teams are pre-positioned in the states which are likely to get affected by heavy rains and all. And all that preparation is there. I mean, I would say we are fairly comfortable in handling this. And there is a regular interaction with the defense forces also on this. There's an integrated defense command on with which we remain in touch. So in case of need, they are also activated and brought in. And it's a system which is well laid down.
All right. On that note, Mr. Bhalla, thank you so much for joining us and sharing all those details with us. And all the very best for all your endeavors, sir.
Thank you very much.